The perspective of applied separation of concerns we will look at in this lesson deals with methods, or functions as we typically call them in other languages. The good news is that there is nothing technically complicated to understand here. All we are doing is breaking down large methods into a series of smaller methods. If you are wondering why we want to do that, I gave you plenty of reasons in the last video, but I still think it is worth showing you exactly what I mean in code. The general idea here is that we want to avoid giant methods as much as possible. Giant methods are difficult to read, difficult to write, difficult to test, and difficult to name. In order to demonstrate an extreme example of this problem, I went through the class in my Sudoku app, which is responsible for drawing and interacting with the user interface. I took the code for drawing the UI from each helper method and stuck it all right into the constructor. I took away all of the static uppercase constants and replaced them with hard-coded values. I also renamed a bunch of descriptive variable names I had from before to some very short ones and got rid of any line comments to explain anything I thought might be confusing. In fairness, short variable names, a lack of comments, and a lack of constant values is a separate issue, but they all represent either a lack of understanding or a lack of effort in writing good quality code. The concept of a helper method is very simple, and it follows a principle which you will see repeatedly in this section. Start from general details and work towards specific details. The constructor of this class has the general goal of initializing whatever needs to be initialized in order to begin a new game. The first three lines here initialize member variables, which I consider to be a unique concern. After that, I call the initializeUserInterface method, which does exactly what it says. Instead of one giant method which contains every line of code to draw the UI, I look at the UI as a series of layers of components. Each method is concerned with setting up one of those components. Now, because we are dealing with a large number of UI elements, my methods are not always tiny. That is okay as long as they each have one particular concern. I am not a big fan of using acronyms, but a good simple one to follow is DRY, or Don't Repeat Yourself. The idea is very simple. Look through your code and pay attention to anything that looks repetitious. Very often, but not always, you can pull that repetitious code into its own helper method. For example, as I was writing this lesson plan, I noticed some repetitious code in the DrawGridLines function. This method is responsible for drawing the lines on top of the puzzle background which form the grid. Notice how these method calls are identical except that their arguments change? That is a clear case of repetition, and I ended up creating a helper function to handle this situation a little more elegantly. Sometimes you have a method which is useful in multiple different classes. In this situation, a good idea is to use a static method like we discussed in section 3. For example, two very common methods in the back end of this application are to take the values of one grid array and copy them to another array, or to create and return a new array. Knowing this, I have pulled these methods out into a separate class which just contains some static helper or utility methods. As mentioned previously, another benefit of SOC at the level of methods is that your code becomes much easier to test. The logic required to generate a new, valid Sudoku game is actually rather complicated and delicate. In truth, I also tend to make lots of small errors, which has been a recurring theme in my life. I have never failed a math test, but I do not recall ever getting 100% because I always make some little arithmetic errors here and there. In order to account for those, I made sure to decompose my method into distinct parts so that I could verify each part individually instead of building mistake on top of mistake on top of mistake.